the issue. This isn't very much, evidence for anything that happened in her life. It also wasn't a life in which very much happened. She wrote an estimated 3,000 letters, but we only have 160, because this is the verbal greater part after Jane's death. So we just don't really know. There's certainly, I think what you can safely discredit are the many films there are about her life. They are very nice to watch and are often very good and often a lot of fun, but there is no biographical evidence upon which they are based. So they make interesting studies of our culture and of our cultural needs, I think, more so than any kind of factual evidence, any kind of factual accounts of Austen's lives. Particularly, I think the need for our culture to put romance into her life is quite interesting. So the number of films and the stories there are about possible romances in her life are really quite astounding where we have no evidence. So what we do know, so she was a clergyman's daughter, that she spent most of her childhood in Steveston in Hampshire, and when her father died, she and her unmarried sister and her mother moved to Bath, which she hated, and the three women eventually settled in Chawton Cottage. Now you remember from our Wollstonecraft sessions that unmarried middle class women couldn't work usually, so they were entirely dependent on their male relatives. Austen had six brothers, so that would be quite, and she then ended up living. Chawton Cottage is on one of her brother's estates, so she was lucky enough to have a brother who looked after her. So neither she nor her sister ever married. We know that Sandra, her sister, had a fiance, and he died abroad, but we don't know very much about possible romances in Austen's life, in Jane's life. So like so many romantic period writers that we've already discussed, she didn't have to, and she didn't write to earn a living. Yes, so writing was not what she made her money with. She certainly didn't make enough for that. Also, of course, her first novel, Sense and Sensibility, didn't come out until she was 35. She must have lived until then. So writing is something she does on the side rather than something she makes her money from. So this is these are the novels. Has anyone read more than just Persuasion? I expect that you've already. Yeah? Good. That's nice. I'm obviously biased, as you know, because my PhD was on Austen and on Scots, and they're the two. They're the two authors that I've mentioned, very biased about. So these are the novels in order of publication. Now, Persuasion and Northumberland weren't published until after her death. I think especially Northumberland must have been very difficult for her. She sent off manuscripts repeatedly to publishers, and they rejected manuscripts. For example, the first version of Pride and Prejudice, then called First Impression, was sent to a publisher who returned it and said he wasn't interested. Now, Northumberland was interesting because she actually managed to sell it in 1803 to a publisher, who said he would publish it and gave her £10 for it. And then he just didn't publish it. So here's her first novel that she thinks somebody's bought, and he just doesn't bring it out. So that must have been a very frustrating experience, especially for an author who hasn't published anything yet. And then she wrote to him a bit later and said, why haven't you published it? And he said, well, you can buy it back if you like, but you can't publish it because I have the copyright. So her brother eventually did buy it back, did buy the copyright back, and it was published after her death. And there are various theories as to why a publisher might behave that way, because it does seem a bit strange to be paying somebody £10 for a copyright and then sit on it. One of the possible reasons is that Northumberland is a parody of the Gothic, or was widely regarded as a parody of the Gothic, and the publisher she'd sold it to specialised in Gothic novels. So it may have been that that publisher just didn't want parodies of the Gothic out there. Now that's about as tentative an explanation, and it may or may not be the case of that, and that is what he did. But anyway, so that must have been quite difficult for her, I think, to still not have anything published. Because she started writing, of course, very early, but Sense and Sensibility didn't come out until she was 35. So really, very late. So Persuasion, the topic of today's lecture is, of course, as you know, Jane Austen's last completed novel. It was published in December 1817. It says 1818 on the title page. Publishers still do that. If it comes out in December 1817, they give it the they say it's published. published the next year, so it looks more current, doesn't it? So they put 1818 on the title page, and when she was writing Persuasion, she was already very ill, and that was of course the symptom of the illness. She then died of a year after the completion of the novel, at the age of 41. Now, the novel's hero and heroines are Frederick Wentworth and Anne Elliot, as you know, meet again 8 years after Anne has been persuaded by her past bunch of family and friends to break off that engagement to the handsome young naval officer who hasn't got any rank or fortune. So the love at the centre of Persuasion has a very different quality from the loves that they find in early Austen novels. So it's not at first romantic love, but a much more thoughtful and right one. So one that comes about only after years of suffering and self-searching. As you also know, Anne is the second of three daughters of the widowed baronet Sir Walter Elliot of Kennet Hall in Somersetshire. Now at 27, Anne is by far the oldest Austen heroine, and she is regarded and regards herself, but is also regarded by the other characters as beyond marriage ability at the beginning of the novel. So she leads a Cinderella-like existence and is a silent observer of her surroundings rather than a participant in them. So her father and her elder sister Elizabeth are conceited and of course respect neither Anne nor her opinions. And her younger sister Mary, who's married to Charles Munro, which you remember in Applecross, is too preoccupied with her life or hypochondriacal worries to pay much attention to others. So it's really only Anne's friend Lady Bustle who treats her as a man. So I'll talk a bit about Heron and her point of view in this novel. So Anne Elliot is 27. She's also the wisest, the most mature, the most educated of Austen's heroines. Whereas other Austen heroines, like Elizabeth Bennet, who you of course might know, or Emma Woodhouse and Emma, gradually acquire self-knowledge and judges herself and other characters reliably from the start. So she's a reliable consciousness from the start.